guess we should kick off and start with perhaps the title of the exhibition, Big Cactus, Little Cactus.
One of the things that I think about a lot is the narrative and stories can be told in many, many different ways. And there's a painting actually behind you, conveniently you will have to turn around, where I have depicted a cactus plant. And then the same plant is depicted from an entirely different angle. So almost as though you've got on your knees and looked at this plant from a different angle, you see it as it's shown on the left of the image. And this is my way of saying, let's see how we can look at something. Let's see how many ways a narrative can be constructed and how many stories we're telling.
The repetition of the same plant in the same image, how does that sort of inform the narrative? What kind of narrative are you trying to tell?
We take it on board, we understand what we're seeing. Our brain accepts what we're seeing, but it's not necessarily the truth. And I think that's something that I'm trying to explore in my paintings, is repetition, proportion, play, and then through into trickery. And we start asking, what is the truth? Does it make sense? And it doesn't even matter.
And what sort of, I guess I should say trickery, game are you playing by, like, with the foreshortening and sort of messing with the spatial relationships between each other?
I think space is something that's a construct that we struggle with. I always start my paintings, well, I've started this series of paintings with a hexagon, because a hexagon is it's a truism, there's no debating it, this is the purest mathematical form, there's no debate, there's no twisting it, it's absolutely there. And then the game begins, and it's where do you go from this point? And I think it's familiar iconography, because these things have a status, if you like, in our society. We give these things weight and value. And for example, I wonder how much we take as a given, how much we just accept as the truth. So for example, we all understand an alpha vase is a desirable design iconic object. And we all know what a spider plant is. It's a sort of a hipster trending plant. You can find it in an IKEA magazine. You can find it in a trendy coffee shop. Yet we put these things together and we say, okay, that works. Then if you look a little bit longer, you look a bit more, you realize that it's entirely false. There's no possible way you could plant, there's no word, you couldn't plant this spider plant in a vase that's entirely transparent. There's no word, because it doesn't work.
The sitter is behind the object in a sense. So the object's sort of presented first in a way. So is it we are the object, we are presented through our objects, our images presented through the objects, what we are.
And I'm interested in how we put ourselves together, how we surround ourselves things, sometimes not even necessarily consciously, in the hope we're presented by the sort of patterns of want, need, commerce, obligation, but they're all eventually choices that we make, things that we put around us. I mean, going back to some of these paintings as an example of the cactus. I live in London, and Urban Outfitters is sort of this, I'm young daughter, and that is her idea of uber cool. And they have like a homeware section in there, which, you know, I would have wanted in my home. For her, she's like, this is how I want my bedroom, and it's full of cactuses because they've decided that's the hipster plant of the moment. And I love the idea of taking an elite vase, sticking a cactus in it, and going, go bigger. I find it really interesting. And then maybe you look a little bit further and you say, well, there's no soil in the vase, and hang on a second, you've repeated the same chair, you know, you've elevated this chair, it's a neutral chair, it's wonderful. She's standing on it, she's sitting on it, and then you jump them all up in the middle. They become sort of an abstract of the chair. So again, we're constantly pushing this idea of value, we're pushing the idea of taste. But ultimately, I think what's really important, we're actually looking at this painting now, so I'm talking about it. For me, this was actually a fairly abstract painting to paint. and I'm very interested in this tension between the figurative, and I'm obviously the work couldn't be any more figurative. I'm taking figures and objects that we're all very much related to, but the abstract nature of painting them is something that's is very interesting to me.
I'm interested in the abstract triptychs of diptych and what music brings the work that you work with them at the same time, or
do I work on the panels at the same time?
On the panels at the same time, are they like next to each other and you paint, or and why do you go into triptychs and diptychs?
They are, and then sometimes they're not. I use it as another part of my game, if you like. So it's another opportunity for play. One of the things that I was very interested in, and I actually try not to think about it too much now because I personally there's a danger for me of over-intellectualizing the work and it never ends well. But I'm very interested in Winnicott and his work with play. And I often will separate the panels, put them back together, add a third one, take it away. I can even take one of one painting and add it onto another painting. So on a practical level, it gives me an excuse to change my game when I want to change my game. And as I said, the intellectualized basis of the work is a basis, but in order to be a happy painter, I need to be physically engaged with the work. And this gives me a very good physical starting point and an opportunity to move away from something I often do and I find incredibly useful is sometimes I just swap around. So I will start this way and then put it that way. I may paint it like that for a couple of weeks and then go, no, I'm back again. And if
more material from magazines, social media, where do these images come from?
Everywhere. I have many architectural monographs, but I also hoard any brochure that comes through my door. I really love this idea of taking something that's really super high-end and desirable and then mixing it with something that, I mean, honestly, you wouldn't buy that thing for your home in a million years. Blank canvas. Blank canvas is almost like, so if it's not a hexagon, well, I will ruin the canvas first. I'll put marks across it. But that feels so arbitrary and ill-considered that I'm not happy with it. It feels lazy. The hexagon is something that I find interesting. I'm not mathematical at all, but I'm interested in the fact that it's nearly a circle, that it has these strict rules which define it as a hexagon. It's an immediate boundary, and it's marked the canvas, and it's a place to start. And it's almost like playing a game where, you know, you roll the dice and there's a first move, and it's slightly arbitrary. You've got to start with a roll of the dice, you've got to start somewhere, and only then can skill and luck play their game. And I talk a lot about surprises. You need to start with something that doesn't surprise you in order for there to be something that later will. So it's almost like it's a cheat. I need to start somewhere, I'll go in with this. And it may change, it may be, you know what, I'm going to go with stripes. Can't imagine that right now, but there's also a three-dimensionality to hexagons, which interests me. So it's yeah, if you start the first roll and then you see what you get, is it a six and a one, where do I go from here?
You're sort of quite intuitive during in the process, but within a sort of,
I need boundaries. If I don't have a boundary, and that was when I went back to art school, I went to art school, I did an MFA and I haven't done a BA. And one of the things I really, really struggled with, I think I'd had this notion that going to art school would give me this total freedom to make any work that my heart desired, and I would just be this kind of boundless creative person, and I was totally paralyzed by the lack of boundaries. There was nothing for me to push against, and it took me pretty much most of my MFA to realize that I was looking for something to push against within which to work, and that would allow me to go further and further and further.
I've got
there are many things that Sara's up to, so
I work in textiles, as well. I work with making textile sculptures, and it's a really different way of making work for me. And then you finish them, and I'm always bereft when I finish a painting.